25 years ago, I invented something that not only has sold more than a billion copies, but that is still actively used by over 200 million unique people each and every month, decades later, to this very day. That's important to me because popularity is one thing, but staying power is really where it's at. For every Macarena, there's a dark side of the moon, and I'd like to think that I actually managed to write two programs that have similarly withstood the test of time. The Windows Task Manager and Windows Zip Folders. And yes, I entirely appreciate that that's where any similarities to Dark Side of the Moon end. Still, having code that I wrote personally surviving in core Windows some 25 years later is actually quite rare and rewarding. And being that they were things that I wrote largely independently and of my own initiative as side projects makes them even more so. This is the story of how Windows Task Manager came to be, followed in part two by a tour and analysis of the actual, never-before-seen Windows source code for Task Manager itself. I'll take you through it and show you how Task Manager works and why I wrote it that way. Among other factors, we'll look at the defensive programming techniques I developed for it and the app's self-healing nature. You'll learn a number of Task Manager secrets never revealed until today. That's largely because I'd forgotten most of them until I saw the code again. In fact, it jogged enough memories that it made me a little nostalgic, so I'll also try to give you a sense of just what it was like to be at Microsoft in the 1990s. For those that don't know me, my name is Dave Plummer. I graduated from the University of Regina and started at Microsoft back in 1993, where I spent the next decade or so working on MS-DOS and Microsoft Windows. While I contributed to Windows 95 and 98, my focus was really on Windows NT and its successors, such as Windows XP. Those were our advanced operating systems, designed by David Cutler, who had also designed VMS before it, and they would evolve into what you're using today in Windows 10. It's all built atop and evolved from our original NT codebase. So how do you go from the U of R to Microsoft? Well, for me, it all started with a book. I was working a summer internship at Sastel, the phone company, and ate my lunch in the mall food court, as the song says, with the old and the bored. I wandered into what was then a Kohl's bookstore and picked up a copy of a book titled Hard Drive, The Story of Bill Gates and the Making of the Microsoft Empire. Frankly, I considered Microsoft to be the crude 800-pound gorilla of the industry, and I was not one of their fans, to be honest. That was until I read the book, however, and encountered the stories of the people and the software projects that went on there. It sounded like a company populated with people that I aspired to be like, working on projects that absolutely fascinated me. I knew immediately, and with great certainty, where I needed to be. Redmond, Washington. The only problem was that it's a long way from Saskatchewan to Redmond, and Microsoft was already receiving something on the order of 100,000 job applications a year. While I did send a copy of my resume to General HR Recruiting, I'm quite certain that I never heard back on that one. Instead, I turned to one of the programs I had written for the Amiga, an operating system utility called Hypercache. In those days before the web, users would typically fill out a registration postcard with their customer info and mail it back to the software vendor for update notifications and that sort of thing. I went through my big stack of blue cards looking for anyone with a Microsoft.com email address, and eventually I found one. It was a fellow named Alistair Banks, and I sent him an email asking if he might suggest anywhere that I could apply directly. He gave me one of the greatest gifts you can give an aspiring graduate, the direct contact emails of a couple managers who were actively hiring operating system developers. Long story short, his contact netted me a phone screening, which led to a phone interview, which then led to an in-person day of interviews down in Redmond, which ultimately landed me a summer internship in the middle of my final year at school. And though we've still never met in person, we stay in touch online and I send him a thank you note on my major anniversaries. I came down to join in on the effort for MS-DOS 6.2, where I was pleasantly surprised to discover that interns are actually given real core features to work on. That summer, I completed tasks like writing a new version of Smart Drive, the system disk cache complete with support for CD-ROM drives. I added single-pass disk copy and used a Delta patching system that I borrowed from the FoxPro database, of all places, to build a version of setup that fit the entire MS-DOS upgrade onto a single floppy disk, potentially saving the company millions of dollars. Not bad for a summer intern in about 3 months, I thought. When my internship ended and I returned for my final semester of school in Regina, much credit is due to the patience of Dr. Howard Hamilton, who mustered me through my final computer science courses that fall as I basked in the glow of being the only student in the Advanced Operating System course to have actually written part of a major commercial operating system. Don't worry, however, as I am certain I handled the situation with all the grace to be expected of anyone in their early 20s. Being an intern might get you on the short list for a full-time interview, but I don't think even I appreciated how little it actually promised in terms of lasting employment. I think I believe that my performance as an intern was my future ticket. But the reality is that you have to completely re-interview all over again with new people that you've never met before, basically starting from scratch. I endured the series of all-day interviews and ultimately secured an offer. It was for $35,000 a year, which I accepted without question. Fortunately, I was also welcomed to the fold with a whack of stock options that it turns out would be a pretty good deal in the long run. As soon as exams were complete, I headed on down to start work in Redmond on the Win32 RPC team, where I had landed a position. A few months later, I'd fly back to Regina for a single weekend to graduate, get married to my high school girlfriend, and then pack everything that remained and immigrate to the United States all in about 72 hours. Upon landing at the U.S. Customs entry point, however, I was pulled aside into the big glass room for additional questioning. After reviewing my application, as my new bride looked on from afar, the immigration officer was yelling at me, turning red and waving his arms. He was very upset and animated, and from her vantage point, it was clear that we were being denied entry and that my Microsoft dreams were crashing down around us right then and there. What she didn't know, because she couldn't hear, was that he had already long since approved my work visa. He was actually upset because their copy of Microsoft Word printed a blank page at the end of every one of their documents and was wasting paper, and he wanted it fixed. I did my best to help reconfigure their page margins before we were released to our new life in America. Back in those days, just like today, I liked to code. I liked to code a lot. In fact, I'd code all day at work at Microsoft and then come home and code on my side projects at night until bed. I'm also the kind of guy who's just genuinely curious about what's going on inside my system and who enjoys seeing machines busy and hard at work. I could literally sit and watch Norton Speed Disk shuttle blocks and sectors around my disk in a fascinating dance for longer than I should probably admit. Heck, I've even defeated the safety mechanism so I could keep the lid open to watch a cycle of my washing machine out of curiosity just to see how it worked. There could be a whole spectrum of reasons why, but I think I'm just wired that way. Now that I was working on a fledgling Windows NT, with all of its complicated internal mechanisms, I wanted to get some insight into what was going on with my own computer as well, and that interest led directly to Task Manager. Today, you might think of Task Manager primarily as a tool for dealing with rogue apps and frozen desktops, but that ability was actually secondary to the monitoring piece of determining what programs were running, what resources were in use, what was still free, who owned what, and most important, what, if anything, looked out of the ordinary. It was really more about inspection than control. You could see how much memory each process was using, how many threads of execution each had operating, how many graphics handles it had outstanding, and so on. With a glance, a developer could now spot a resource leak with ease. In a way, it's a debugging tool written by a developer that even end users ultimately found useful. I wrote the first drafts of Task Manager in my den at home and then took the resultant rough program into work. In those days, we followed a practice known as eating our own dog food, which meant we were self-hosted on the newest daily builds of Windows NT even as we worked to create them. Eventually, a number of other developers talked me into giving them copies of my Task Manager, and it spread amongst the team. It eventually came to the notice of Dave Cutler, the designer of Windows NT and second at the company perhaps only to Bill Gates as far as we were concerned. Fortunately, he was a fan of the fledgling Task Manager and gave me permission to put it into the main Windows source tree. Once I had put it into the product, a senior developer named Mark Lukowski was essential to keeping it there. He served as its occasional champion, fending off the complaints from the designers of Windows 95, who found the whole thing overly technical and nerdy in a way that ran contrary to their mission of simplifying the PC experience. Of course, it likely didn't help that Dave C. initially had me put it at the very top of the start menu, which was basically received as a big middle finger by the Windows 95 shell designers. I moved the link to somewhere reasonable like System Tools and everyone was satisfied. No money exchanged hands and no contracts were signed. I simply added it to the project source tree and changed the copyright headers. It was very much a Wild West in comparison to how you would go about it today. The best part about it at the time, at least from my perspective, was that once I'd added it to the product, my favorite hobby then became my day job. The software that I'd been tinkering with in my den now became my primary full-time job for a couple months. It'd be very much like if you had a hobby of building and painting little birdhouses, and then one day you brought it in to show your boss, and your boss said, "You know, Dave, we really like your little birdhouses. We're going to pay you to build them here at work, too." My birdhouses just happened to be Task Manager. Contrast that experience with the one I had about a year later, involving the system software known as zip folders. That's the code that enables you to download and browse through zip archives using the Windows shell, and it lets you drag and drop in and out to compress and decompress files and so on. I had written it at home and released it as shareware after getting permission to do so. I was selling perhaps a dozen copies a day when somehow a Windows product manager at Microsoft stumbled across the utility and decided that it, too, belonged in the operating system as part of Windows. To that end, she called me at home quite early one morning before I'd left for work to explain that they wanted to purchase the program from me for inclusion in Windows and would I be willing to discuss it. I offered to stop right on by her office that morning, which seemed to spook her a little bit. She demurred and said that I should talk to Microsoft Travel, which confused the heck out of me. Why should I schedule a travel visit to Microsoft when I worked there every day? In fact, at that time, I lived only a few blocks away and I could walk. And it turned out, after some uncomfortable back and forth, that she had no idea that I worked at Microsoft, just as she did. She had merely researched, tracked down, and then cold called the author of zip folders, who happened to be me, at home to explore an acquisition. As a result, my choices were actually quite limited. If I did not sell it to Microsoft, they would simply develop their own or buy a competing one, and I'd have to stop selling mine or quit my day job. I couldn't just continue selling mine in competition with my own employer once they had entered that market. And so, I cheerfully accepted their first, best, and only offer. Still, everyone was happy. I showed up at work the next week in a red Corvette, and zip folders remains as part of Windows to this very day. According to the New York Times, Microsoft's initial public offering is said to have created some 12,500 new millionaires at the company. Being the new guy, I was certainly not among them yet, but working with people who are worth tens of millions of dollars, yet still who act like normal folks in a lunchroom, is humbling and centering. And when they clearly do not need to work, yet they're passionately putting in 16-hour days and sleeping under desks to do it, it's also more than just a little motivating. You can't really blow out at 4:30 on a Friday when everyone else is on a death march. Ah yes, the death march. Hardly a politically correct term then or now, it was used to describe the phases of a product cycle, sometimes months long and sometimes one running into the next, where the limitation of how much work you put in isn't what's reasonable, it's what's possible. If you've already worked a 14-hour day, but you haven't found the critical bug, and it's possible to work a 17-hour day, then that is what you do. If you need to sleep under your desk, you put a sticky note on your door that reads, "Please email," and you take a nap on your floor under your desk. As for me, I'm no dummy. I had a small sofa bed installed in my office. If you need to wake up, you wander out to one of the portable barista stations serving lattes up and down the hallway. Eat in the food courts, play some Robotron or Tempest in the build lab. Whatever it took to keep us there, or more accurately, to ship the milestone as soon as possible, they were willing to provide. Early one Sunday morning, about 5 a.m., I received a call from my boss that there was a showstopper build break in a component that I was a backup contact on, calculator or space cadet pinball or some such thing. They can't reach whoever normally owns a component, but it's broken and it's blocking the entire build. If you don't fix it, not only does a test build not come out, but you're wasting the time of about 350 developers who depend on it each day. So even though I had just made it to bed a few hours earlier, I dragged myself back into work and fixed whatever it was that was broken. My boss's boss was very appreciative, which is why, on Monday when I got to work, I found a pair of Dave Cutler's courtside NBA tickets pinned to my corkboard. Now, I'm not a big NBA fan, but I am a fan of having popcorn and snacks brought to me courtside by waiters, and my wife and I had a great time rubbing elbows with the local rich and famous. It's actually the last NBA game I've ever been to, and if I recall, the Supersonics beat the Bullets. I hope that part doesn't date me. Be sure to join me for part 2, which looks at Task Manager from a more technical perspective and the hows and whys of how it was written. I'd very much appreciate it if you enjoyed this look back at the Windows Task Manager that you share this video with some of you know that actually like such things. Odds are if you enjoyed this video, then you know somebody that's kind of in the same vein and will also enjoy the video, but they may never run across it. So to the extent you can forward along to them, I really appreciate that kickstart. Share it on Facebook, put it on Twitter, whatever you need. It's a very narrow niche, obviously, so I'm entirely dependent on your shares and word of mouth. Can a Task Manager video even go viral? Not without your help, it can't. So text or email someone the link to the video, or you could click on the share button in the toolbar below the video, even if you've never clicked on it before. It won't bite, it won't hurt, so give it a try. Consider it your personal growth and good deed for the day. I know I'd certainly appreciate it. If you'd like to see future installments, do be sure to subscribe to Dave's Garage and turn on the bell icon and personal recommendations. If you found today's Task Manager Tales informative or entertaining, please leave me a like on the video. If you did not, consider sending me a strong message by clicking on dislike twice. That will really get my attention. If you've got any questions, fire away in the comments. I'll do my best to answer. Thanks, and I'll see you next time here in Dave's Garage. This little chair will be waiting for one of you, and a rocking chair for another who likes to rock, and a big armchair for two to curl up in. All next time on Dave's Garage.